Good morning, and welcome to the celebration of the third Sunday of Easter. Those of you who are present and those of you who are joining us on live stream, welcome. Let us stand for our opening song, Glory in the Cross.
Glorious day in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Join in the dance of heaven and earth as we continue our Easter tour. Today we've got Luke's version of John's gospel, or last week we had John's version of Luke's gospel. But he's showing up. As long as he shows up, we're going to be just fine. And he never stops showing up. We open our hearts to receive the grace of the divine as we continue our journey towards the fullness of the kingdom. Jesus, you appear to your disciples once more. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You tell them to touch you because ghosts do not have flesh and bones. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
The disciples rejoice in having the touch of the divine upon them. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Peace on earth, grace to bring all good men.
Oh, may your people rejoice forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confidence and confident hope to the rejoicing that lasts forever on the day of the resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death, but God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the
struck with power, God's mercy is exalted.
reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, I am writing this to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate in the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. The way we may be sure that we know him is to keep his commandment. Those who say, I know him, but do not keep his commandments, are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now the two disciples returned from Emmaus, and they recounted what had taken place on the way and how Jesus was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Now while they were still speaking about this, Jesus stood in their midst and he said to them, Shalom, peace be with you. But they were terrified and startled. They thought they were seeing a ghost. And then Jesus said to them, Why are you troubled? And why do you questions arising in your hearts like this? Look at my hands, my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see that I have. Now, as he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Now, while they were still incredulous for joy and were amazed, he asked them, have you anything to eat here? And they gave him a piece of baked fish, and he took it, and he ate it in front of them. He said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms, it had to be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to the understanding of the scriptures, and he said to them, well, thus it was written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. Now you are the witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Please be seated. It's good from time to time to ask ourselves, what is so unique about being a Christian, about Christianity? Especially from other kinds of religious experiences, because it is a religion among many religions. And of course, religion simply means to religio means to tie things together, to bind things together. And of course, what is trying to be bound together in any religion is the idea of God and the idea of ourselves, and somehow they are joined, they're somehow connected to each other. But one of the great differences is that most religions, and in Judaism as well, always sees God as out there. And therefore it is imperative for us to do something to get that God's attention, that God will bless us and will march with our armies and will take care of us and make us as special as we possibly can be, especially when we see it in the light of other religious factions that are all around us. And so every religion says we want to get to our God. We will make sacrifices for our God. We will keep the laws that this God seems to be giving to us as they are pronounced through the prophets. We will keep the covenants, and of course they don't, and the covenants break, but they still really believe that somehow they're special. I don't think it's by mistake that the church lady's favorite saying is, "Isn't that special?" And aren't we special? No, the prophets have told the Jewish people, "You are the chosen people. God has chosen you, but not because you are better than. It's because God is going to keep God's commandments. If God has made you a promise, he's going to be faithful. You may be unfaithful, but God will remain faithful." But you know, I don't believe they believed it. And all you need to do, pick up the Psalms, especially at Lauds every morning. And the very first Psalm is always about God marching with our armies, conquering our enemies, making us the best, better than. Not one among, but the better than. And Hilaire Belloc, the Catholic apologist, once wrote a very famous couplet. At least it's ascribed to him. And the couplet goes like this. "Now, how odd of God to choose the Jews." Now, they thought that was just really scandalous when it first came out. And today, it almost seems like it could be anti-Semitic, but that wasn't his intention at all. And the question for us is, okay, if God has chosen the Jews and they are the chosen people, what does that make us? How do we get to God? And of course, we come to a realization that what makes Christians different from every other religion is Christ. Is Christ. Is the Christ. We do not believe that we have to scar and cut ourselves to get to God. But, well, as John makes so clear in his prologue, that the eternal Word came down and took on human flesh and dwelt among us. We don't have to work to get to God. The hound of heaven is down here trying to get to us, to enter into who we are. And St. Paul says it so beautifully, and I guess it probably is, well, it's hard to choose your favorite passage, but though he was in the form of God, he did not deem equality with God as something to be grasped at. He emptied himself, that great kenosis, taking human form. Today he's trying to describe to the disciples, as he's opening their minds to the scriptures, as he did the same thing with the disciples on the road to Emmaus, "Did not the Son of Man have to come and to embrace the pain, the hurt, the mendacity of the human situation and to suffer the ultimate ignominy of death in order to come into the fullness of life?" That's the great joy. And what is that great joy that makes it so special? And I once received a Christmas card that was kind of a play on the Hilaire Belloc couplet that said this. On the outside of the card it said, "How odd of God to have a bod." And then you open up in the inside, it says, "Yeah, but really nice." How odd of God to have a bod, to become one of us. What makes Christianity absolutely unique is that the divine enters into the material world, into human flesh. And in Jesus, it is the fullness of God and the fullness of humanity. And we are now invited to share in that fullness, that incredible exchange between the divine and the human. You know, we hear a lot these days, and especially in the last 50 years or so, about the connection between the body and the mind and the spirit. The older I'm getting, the more aware I'm becoming is that they are not bound together as three separate entities by some kind of divine twine. I'm really beginning to believe that there's only one reality. There may be three different manifestations, a bodily manifestation, a mind manifestation, and a spiritual manifestation, but there's only one reality, and they are absolutely inseparable. Body, mind, and spirit are one. Now that goes back to the ancient times of Rome, when you would see on the gymnasiums that they stole from the Greeks, but they would put it in Latin, you know, sana mens, corpore sano, healthy mind, healthy body. Healthy body, healthy mind. And of course, we add spirit to that, which is the principle of life beyond all of it. So healthy mind, healthy spirit, healthy body, healthy mind, and it goes back and forth. We are not just spirit. Jack Shea used to tell the wonderful story of the little boy who's going to bed, and mommy tucks him in, and he says, mommy, give me a glass of water. She gives him a glass of water. And she starts walking away. He goes, mommy, please, would you read me a bedtime story? She reads him a bedtime story. He goes back and he goes, mommy, stay here. I'm scared. And she says, you have nothing to be scared of. God is here, and God will be with you. He says, I know God's here, but I want somebody with some skin. I want to touch. I want to feel. I want to know this is real. This is what I seek. This is what we all seek. We want to touch. We want to feel. We want to know that it is real. The difficulty in the world in which we live today is that we have forgotten the spiritual side because we get so caught in the material side. And especially with modern pharmacology, we are convinced that all we need to do is take care of the body, whatever the physical manifestation is, not to worry about the mind or the spirit, and we will do that at our peril. And we've all, I'm sure, heard the old story, and it really is an old story, but a valid one of the little orphanage right after the Second World War. And in the orphanage, there were two floors. And on the first floor, the little orphan babies were dying. On the second floor, the orphan babies were staying very healthy. They didn't know why one floor was dying, the other floor was staying very healthy. The doctors were really at a loss because they were being fed exactly the same thing. The houses were immaculately clean. Everything was just the way it was supposed to be. Finally, one night, in his frustration, one of the doctors stayed there all night just to see what was going on. And as he was in the first floor, he noticed the Fräulein, the cleaning lady, just cleaning up a storm, making sure that everything is absolutely immaculate because these were the babies who were dying on her. And she'd go from one to the next to clean everything around them. He went upstairs and he saw the cleaning lady upstairs who was also cleaning, but not quite the same, because she would go to each baby. And as she would go to each baby, she'd pick it up, hold it, hug it, touch it, kiss it, and then put it back in the bassinet. And these babies are thriving. We know the story. We know the reality. Love heals, and no love, no life. It is the intimate connection between all of them. They cannot be separated. And all of that is to basically introduce us into the gospel of today. Because the disciples on the road to Emmaus have their eyes opened, what? In the very material breaking of the bread. And there they see the Christ. and know the Christ. And they're rushing back to tell their fellow disciples that it's exactly the same time. Obviously, Jesus is really good at bilocating because he's showing up as soon as they get there. And the first reaction, and they say that pretty much this is always the first reaction for every theophany. Every time there is a manifestation of God, or every time an angel appears, they're always shocked, because the first word out of their mouth has to be, "Don't be afraid, for Christ, don't be afraid," you know, which makes you wonder what the angels probably looked like, but don't be afraid. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying. Why are you terrified? Because they think they're seeing a ghost. They think they're seeing, and they are scared out of their wits. Until what? Until he tells them to touch him. Touch me. Ghost doesn't have bones. A ghost doesn't have flesh. Touch me. And he showed them his hands and his side. And what happens immediately, and I think this is really kind of marvelous, what happens immediately is they've gone from being terrified because they think they're seeing a ghost to being utterly joyful because they're being touched, physically touched. The power of touch, the connection, and it's not just a connection, the reality between the physical, the mental, the emotional, and the spiritual. We are of one peace, and now they are at peace. It's this wonderful power to heal, and it is always the power of touch. We paid a great price during COVID by being so isolated from each other, and many of our young people are still paying for that. But we who are old enough have lived through enough to be able to go on, but some have really suffered by that isolation and have not been able to overcome that isolation as yet. I've learned long ago that when I anoint somebody, especially if they're going to be going for surgery, because I believe the best medicine is preventive medicine, and is to touch. And I always ask, if we're going to anoint somebody, make sure the family's there, make sure the family's around them. And I ask the entire family, as we pray them through the surgical procedure, to touch him. Why? Love heals. It's not just a body, mind, spirit, soul connection. It's all one reality. And if you take care of the mind, you will take care of the spirit. If you take care of the spirit, you'll take care of the body. If you take care of the body, you will also take care of the mind and the spirit and the soul. We're learning that more and more, and it's a great, great reality. And we, as Catholics, are most privileged to be able to believe. As a matter of fact, we will say it. It's our custom here at this wonderful OLA chapel to pray the Apostles' Creed, that we believe in the resurrection of the body. The body is sacred. The body is holy. And the body heals. I think I may have shared the story of the little girl who comes up with a scrape on her arm, and she's crying her eyes out. "Mommy, Mommy, I hurt my hand." And Mommy says, "Let me make it better." And she goes, mm-hmm. She puts bacteria all over it, and the kid gets better. Well, of course. Now, the psychosomatic, that is psychosomatic. It is the psyche healing the soma. They are that incredibly not connected. They are that incredibly the same reality. That's and we as a sacramental church, one of the great gifts of incarnation, incarnate, that the divine dwells in the flesh. The great gifts of incarnation is the material part of what we do in our sacramental system that says this isn't just pointing to a outside reality, this is the deepest reality. We dare to believe. Richard Rohr often says, you know, the Catholic Church has a much easier time seeming to convince bread that it is sacred than we do each other. Yeah. And I think he's right. that the divine is shot through with all of the material world. It was Francis who showed us that there's no separation between sacred and profane. It's all the one great reality. And we are to bow before that. And we are to say amen before that. Rohr also pointed out once that as he was giving up the Christ, and he was saying the body of Christ, and the body of Christ, and there was a little four-year-old with his mother, and after she stepped aside, he tugged on her sleeve, and he says, "The body of Christ?" She said, "Yeah." "The whole body?" She said, "Yeah." "Does that include his butt?" Yeah. We are what we eat. We become who we are. We become who we are. We are nothing less than the divine in the material world. And the material world needs to understand, and we need to treat the material world as sacred because it is. Because it is sacred. There is no division between sacred and profane. That's a mental construct. The great reality is that all is one, and the sacred dwells in each and every creature on earth, and each and every person on earth. Our problem is we don't believe it. You know, Gandhi once said to us Catholics, he said, "If you people really believe what you say, you would be genuflecting before each other constantly, because you would see the divine in each other and the holy in each other." The Japanese have their namaste, which means I do see it. And I think that's not a bad way to begin to see, but then also to somehow touch. Of course, the question for us is, do we believe it? Do we believe it? And of course, and if as we hold up the body of Christ to each other, our response is to be amen. So I ask you, sisters and brothers, do you believe it? And you say,
amen.
Now I gotta tell you, that includes your crazy Uncle Leo. And let us stand to pray. And as is our tradition indeed, we will pray the Apostles' Creed, where we say, we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the great body of Christ. And we are the body of Christ in space and time. What he did, we do. We profess the faith because we are called to do just that. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day he rose again in fulfillment. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We now come to celebrate who we are as Christians, as the divine Christ dwelling in each and every one of us, and in the divine Christ dwelling in all of humanity, no matter what they may call themselves. For we are all called to be one, which is the great prayer of the Christ. And so we pray. You've got it good.
Please respond, God of love, hear our prayer.
God of love, hear our prayer.
For the church, that we may be witnesses to the risen Christ, revealing his presence in our acts of mercy and love, and bringing his healing touch to those in need Let us pray to the Lord.
God of love, hear our prayer.
For all those who are in authority, that they may pursue justice, right the wrongs that persist, and lift up those who are oppressed, let us pray to the Lord.
God of love, hear our prayer.
That the peace given by the risen Christ to his disciples may continue to spread and flower all over the world, let us pray to the Lord.
God of love, hear our prayer.
For those who are ill, imprisoned, homeless, or neglected, that they and those who care for them may recognize Christ in each other, let us pray.
God of love, hear our prayer.
For ministry fund grant recipients serving those with little or no access to medical and dental care, let us pray.
God of love, hear our prayer.
For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions, spoken and unspoken, let us pray.
God of love, hear our prayer.
A merciful God, invisible God, your Son, Jesus Christ, became incarnate in the flesh that we may share in your divinity. It is the divine exchange that we now are the body of Christ in space and time. Grant us the strength and the faith to proclaim the kingdom, to work for the kingdom. We pray all of this in the name of the one who gives us that strength, Jesus the Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Beloved family of God, let us now pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, our beloved Amma and Abba. May the Lord accept his sacrifice from our hands to the praise and glory of God's name for our good and the good of all God's holy church. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church. And as you have given us cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in our perpetual happiness. We pray this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Truly is right. It's just. It's our duty and our salvation to acclaim you at all times, but even more so to laud you during this wonderful time of Passover when Christ has been sacrificed and has risen from the dead. For the old order is now destroyed, and a universe that was cast down is to be renewed, and the integrity of life is to be restored to us in the Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as we and they acclaim. You are the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So at the time he was betrayed and he entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and he gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar manner, when supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and praise. He gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you, for the many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and to serve you. We humbly pray that as we partake of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of love, together with Francis, our Pope, Ronald, our bishop, the clergy, religious, and all the beautiful Easter people you gather before you this day. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, Saints Francis and Clara, Mother Clara, Mary Ward, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may come to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by the divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father.
thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. And graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace. My peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. And graciously grant her the peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us reach out and touch someone. Let us share some sign of Christ's peace.
Peace.
Bless you, sister. Behold, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. How blessed and happy are we who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Christ. Good morning.
Good morning.
We'd like to welcome Sister Melanie Paradise back.
Amen.
She is with us this morning. We're glad that she's home. But that's not it.
Amen.
Today is her birthday.
Amen.
So we must sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
We are the body of Christ. Somebody reach out and touch as we bless her. Stand up, sister, and a special blessing upon her. Heavenly Father, your beloved community, the body of Christ, now touches the holy body of your daughter, and we pray that it continues to fill her with your grace, your goodness, your healing, your love. Oh, we thank you for the not just the service to this community, but the great love that she has shared with the community. Fill her with all good things. And all good things are of the Christ, and we too are of the Christ, who lives forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let us stand to pray. Oh my goodness, really? Yes. Amen. Amen. Let us stand to pray. Oh, Lord, look with kindness upon your people, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the fullness of life, of bodily resurrection. We pray this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go forth now, glorifying the Lord by our lives. Thanks be to God.